Should we start?
Some stuff about the feedback and the conference as well. Do you have any presentation or is just going to be?
Yeah, just get the link and you can just use it. Okay, cool.
Hey guys, thank you all for coming. Please, if you have any feedback about the talks or the conference, feel free to leave any feedback on the schedule app. Also, we got some perks here for best questions during the workshop. And yeah, so that's all. Just go ahead.
Hey, good morning, guys. Good to see full house here. My name is Nipendra Khare. I'm currently doing my own startup in Bangalore, India, for container training and consulting. Earlier I was Red Hat for 3 years, basically two times Red Hat earlier. Last time I was 3 years, I was doing performance engineering for Red Hat and looked after Gluster, some for OpenStack and OpenShift there. Last year, I also wrote a book on Docker called Docker Cookbook. Yeah, that's a kind of short intro. Before we kind of formally start, how many of you have used Docker? It's really good. And how many of you used any of the orchestration tools earlier, like Swarm, Compose, Kubernetes, Mesos? Really good number. Yeah. Good. So hopefully people who are new here, they can get to learn something. And you already know something. I mean, already have used something, they can be a part of the communication or the conversation what we have today. And while creating all the container, Docker, or everything, whatever we're doing in that way, our end goal is always been to run containers or the applications, right? Whatever this will be. So our end goal is always been to run an application. Other than we talk about containers, but that container is by itself is nothing. I mean, it's just like you use a bunch of features from Linux kernel or maybe now in Windows also. So you can just take in some application like Nginx and all that and just run it individually is fine. But our eventual goal is to run it a three-tier application or multi-tier application on the production. That's where you want to go, rather than just running on a laptop. So when you create any applications on a laptop, you say Docker runs something and it just runs just fine. But when you go in production, you need to have a group of machines which work together. And then you should be able to kind of say that dynamically, that I want to scale my application to and replica or n instance of that. So think about a use case. You are doing a shopping or you are running a e-commerce company and during the Christmas season you would see that a lot of sales are going to happen. So you have to plan for that. So if you kind of just running a simple one node, one Nginx, one web server or one database and all that, eventually that's going to kind of fail if this load comes to the website on a given day. So what do you want to have is, you need to have some kind of auto scale mechanism. So when you kind of say, okay, now if I'm going to see my lot of load, I should be able to increase my web interface by n times, shrink down as I don't have enough people coming to my website. So our initial goal would be to kind of do auto scaling, those kind of features. So we want to reach there. Other feature you'd like to have is basically, if you're running a version X of your application right now, and you want to upgrade to the new version, and the one way is to like shut down your entire operation and then do the second version of the image then or the application and deploy it. The other way is to kind of do a rolling updates. You can say, okay, I'm going to run some part of the application right now and some part of the new version, and eventually I'll move to the new version slowly without hitting any of my downtime. So that's where we want to go with Docker in production. And so that's what I'm going to look at today. Docker orchestration tools, which would basically would allow us to do all of these things. So I was thinking of preparing the Vagrant thing and where we want to try the workshop, but if everybody try to do it right now, we can't finish the workshop. So what I have is everything around written in the GitHub pages. I'll just get this link. Currently, just follow along with me, and if you can, if you have internet speed, which is good enough, you can just do as with you, because there are going to be like four containers, four VMs for Swarm, then three or four for Kubernetes, and then again four for Mesos. So I would recommend that you just follow along, understand the concept, and if you have someone, just feel free to share. Because this has been a kind of a good learning experience for me also. I have been just kind of focusing on Kubernetes till now, but because of this workshop, I get the chance to learn about Swarm as well as the Mesos as well. So these are a few things why we want to have orchestration. Everybody knows about pets and kettles, right? So if you kind of, if you take an application which is like so complicated or so complex, you want to make sure that you update them very, very carefully, rather than it should happen automatically. So basically, what do you want to have your typical or very complex application which is critical to you should be updated automatically, should be able to do things automatically, rather than you have to go and manually do these things. So that's why we say that, we don't want pets in the server farms. We just all want kettles. That even in production, you should be able to upgrade auto scale dynamically. Yeah, this is what we talked about. The one thing we want to go also is across cloud providers. We just want to, let's say you're running all your stuff currently on AWS, but you want to make sure that you have some part of your infrastructure on Google or DigitalOcean. And how you should be able to basically, you're running the same application, but you should be able to have multiple cloud providers. So some of the orchestration tools allows you to kind of run it across different cloud providers. If not, they'll be coming with those features so that you can have your application running on multiple clouds. These are some of the examples. What are being there? Docker Swarm, Kubernetes, Mesos, Diego, Apache Aurora, Amazon ECS, Azure. So there are all these features which basically allow you to run containers in an orchestrated way, the way you provide things. So we're going to look at today top three, Docker Swarm, Kubernetes, and Mesos. And features, so this page is going to get updated frequently. So basically, if even if not covering today, but eventually if you kind of being in this page, you should be able to see for all of them. And happy if you're able to contribute, if you can send some pull requests for other things also. It's also really good. So, so what we need to run container and orchestrated build. So basically, what do we need? So first of all, running containers in production will require you to run containers in multiple nodes. You just don't run a container just on one machine. If the machine fails, everything fails. So that's something what we want to have. You would like to have how you bind those nodes together in a cluster, right? So basically, you can say that okay, one of my you can take five machines. You can say them, okay, some of them are master, which is kind of going to delegate their work to the nodes or the slaves. And then they should work in synchronization so that you can update, you can manage your applications. What you also need is container engines. We know Docker. I don't know about Docker that. You can use Docker to run containers. You can also use Rocket. Rocket is from CoreOS, so you can use Rocket to run the containers and the Rocket also. So now, the next one is very important, that there should be a single source of truth which everybody should be able to believe. That if I am saying something, that is truth. So that some source, it should be a kind of a key value pair. So think about an application, think about so let's say you are in a cluster of machines, right? Now, if one of the master goes down or some of the nodes goes down, then how somebody would know that my cluster is now in the sync state or the way it should be? Or let's say if you are developing an application, you should look at now, for this application, create an instance or like create 5 replicated containers for my app. Now, how would I know that 5 of them are running? Now, if something goes down, then how would I know now one thing goes down, I should be now running 4? Now it's 4, I should move to 5, something like that. So there should be a single point of truth that should be able to help you out or help the cluster orchestration thing. So just like etcd and console, Zooku pair are the kind of examples what you can think of a key value pair. So it's like I can just set a key saying that okay, I can say now my app name is something or my container name is this, something like this. So that goes and set in the key value pair. Now somebody want to retrieve it, they can go and retrieve it. So think about, any questions here? The pace is okay, you're able to hear me, understand me. Cool. Now running the containers just on one machine is fine. But when you try to connect the containers running on different machines, think about you are running a web tier on some machine and you are running a DB tier on some other machine. So now the containers, when they talk to each other, they have to go through the same host machine, right? Think about these are 2 hosts and you're running containers each one of them, right? Now, the container from this machine, if they want to reach to container on another machine, they have to pass through the same host machine, right? They cannot go from anywhere else. So now, how do you connect these containers from multiple machines together and form a flat network? Right, so that's one problem what you have to solve. So there's some of the things like a VXLAN. How many of you know VXLAN? Tunneling and OpenStack or what? So basically you can say that okay, now transferring my data from one container to the other machine, I'm going to use my existing network, but I'll send my packet what I want to send it there. So I'm going to use some kind of tunneling okay, let me just clarify that thing. So think about, this is the kind of a VXLAN kind of packet. So if you recall in your whatever CS course you have done, you would have learned about IP address, header, and the payload. So this is the kind of a payload, packet, what you send from one machine to another machine. So what you have is, this is, so as I mentioned, that's good. So let's say this is your, these are 2 different machines. This is your container 1. This is your container 2. And this is your ETH interface on this machine. So what would happen is, this guy can easily go to this guy, like a typical LAN environment. But if this guy want to send something, what it will do, it will create a packet. Let's say packet 1. This would kind of go to this machine, and this guy would create basically an outer packet to send to that place. So basically what you're seeing here is the outer packet which is getting sent from this machine to this machine. And this packet, what is this guy is generating, this goes on the payload, like P1 packet goes here, and this packet goes this side, and then outer one get decapsulated, and then this P1 go like this. Something like this. I'm just giving you a very top level overview. This is a kind of MAC address, so you can see that the packet diagram is the outer packet, and then in that you would see the VXLAN header, and then you would see the inner source MAC address and all that. So basically, if C1 wants to send to C2, it would basically generate a packet. This would go part of the bigger packet and send across. This is something called tunneling of VXLAN, what you have. That's why you have to solve this problem if you want to create a cluster of containers, cluster of nodes which run containers. And then once you have this kind of, this is a kind of one example, but you can have some other ways also to do this thing, like in different layer of the network. So now, because of this, what Docker and Kubernetes have done, they have created some kind of pluggable architecture in which you can attach different kind of drivers which will allow you to do this thing, container communication between nodes. Yeah, so there would be, so when you create a cluster of nodes to make the container orchestration work, there should be some master and there should be some slave. So what job of the master is going to kind of say, run n copies of this application on my cluster. If my one container dies, create a new container. So that's the job of the master, who would take care of this management, who would kind of say, okay, now run n copies of the container or schedule my container on this particular machine. Think about if you have a cluster of nodes, one machine have SSDs, and you want to say that, okay, make sure this container gets started on the machine which have SSD. So you can put those kind of rules when creating containers, saying that, okay, now, so this is the job of the master, or the master would kind of decide where it should go. So master would have the info of all the nodes. Once they have all the nodes, it will kind of decide where should our container go. Okay. Then you get the kind of affinity also, like you can say that, okay, now, you can set this container as on this machine and all that. So those are kind of things you can do. Now, so once you have this thing, we have a node, you have a cluster of nodes, you have a master, you have a network and all that. Then you would need a way to figure out a service or service discover. So basically the idea is, because containers are mortal, containers can die and come any point of time. So always remember, when you run containers, you have to prepare that container can die in time. It will come anywhere else. Think about a container running on machine 1. If this dies for some reason and it shows in some other machine, some other node of the cluster. Now, because if you are running in transaction, now how that should go across? Because the container dies somewhere, it comes somewhere else. So you should have some kind of mechanism to identify my container is now running on some other machine. That's one way. That's one thing. Other thing also is, how would you let's come back to that. So we need to need some way to kind of discover that where my current application is running right now. So that you have to first kind of run decide where it should be running, and you have to kind of broadcast that, okay, this particular application now run on some machine node or node 2 or node 3, whatever. So you need to dynamically change your connections, or basically you have to maintain the connection, but still you have to move to different nodes. I think we'll finish the example, it will become more clear. And then you need to kind of do a load balancing also. So basically when you are running the, let's say you are running the same application 5 times, if you are running the web front, you are running the front end on 5 different machines. Then for the outside world, you're going to just reach to one endpoint, and that endpoint has to kind of do the load balancing, so that so let's say as a client you basically connect to some IP address, which is IP address of a load balancer. Now this has to get connected to different containers, C1, C2 and all that. And so basically if you start a connection, you always connect to this by one. But this guy has to make sure that this sends connection to each one of them in round robin or some other way, so that you kind of don't just connect to one container, you can just do the load balancing and round robin on all those things. Any questions here?
Cool. So either I'm doing a good job or a bad job.
I really don't know.
What did the interrupted work, which was done on the node on the container, which, for example, crashed?
What is the?
When one node with container actually, container crashed, and what was the work which was done over that container?
So that intelligence, you have to build an application. So you cannot just say that, okay, I'm going to just die any point of time, and whatever I had said that I was going to die with that. So you need to build an application also with that in mind, that you would crash any point of time. So you need
what with the feedback? What is done? The work was...
So work is, so you have to do define the work. If you're just saying defining the work is like serving the web page.
For example, compilation.
Compilation. So in that case, you not get the output what you want, and then complete thing again start from the scratch again.
Okay.
It can't just kind of be there and just, you have to start from the scratch again because you haven't got the output as the client, right? So the load balancer would say, okay, now if this dies, schedule this job here because it's not working.
With regards to what he said, in similar scenarios, what we can do is probably have a storage model, which is not inside the container, have an external storage model, a volume container.
No,
right?
I'm saying,
so whatever you compile,
the feedback that wasn't done, and you probably should rerun this.
That container cannot, that application cannot handle. You cannot just like handle that, okay, now half of work has been done, half should be somewhere else. That's not something which you can do in this kind of scenarios.
Okay.
You have to, if you're talking about transactions, let's talk about bank transaction you were talking about, then that intelligence has to be built on that application. That should know that, okay, now because transaction has not been completed, I should not take this, I should do it again. So this kind of intelligence has to be built in your application.
Okay.
Okay, now there would be, so once you kind of start building a containers, so now the containers, whatever the storage they have, that's ephemeral storage, right? That can basically, if you start the container, you do some file creation or write some content to that. If you don't save it back to the disk, it's gone if the container dies, right? That's one thing. Other thing is, so let's say now container one moves from one machine to another machine and you are doing some operations. And now what would happen to those? Basically, you're saving some data in the disk. Now, because the container moved from one machine to another machine, the other machine would not have the same backend storage, what has been moved. So you need to have some kind of shared storage which has been given to the all the nodes on the cluster. Think about your NFS, ClusterFS. So those kind of shares you have to be giving to all the nodes in the cluster when you create. And when the container kind of moved from one place to another place, it has to kind of, because the same storage is on the other side also, they should be able to work as it is, because your storage is being kind of shared across them. So you need this kind of plugins. So that's why when Docker kind of came along, it came a very good hype. I mean, people have been using it, but then they are start going to move in production, they'll hit this problem. Two of them was like networking and the storage. So this problem has to be solved before anybody can go in production. And that's why they kind of came up with networking plugins and storage plugins, so that even though they have something, but other guys can also come along and do that. Like for Red Hat, we're doing ClusterFS and Ceph plugins for Kubernetes and for Docker. So basically, when you create a cluster of nodes, you should have automated way of mounting the volume, unmounting it, and all of those things. So all of these things will come played together, only then you can run your containers in production. Okay, so now any questions?
Yeah, I have a question concerning these storage plugins, but I guess you will come to that later anyway, because what's available in Kubernetes, for example?
Yeah.
What's the best practice?
Yeah, that we can really talk about.
Yeah.
Okay, so now for this kind of workshop,
What I wanted to do eventually is kind of have a kind of a real world application and which we can deploy on all three platforms. How many of you heard about Magento? Magento, which is an e-commerce platform. So you can just kind of take that platform and you can put down on your, you can deploy it on your nodes or whatever, and you can compete e-commerce platform. And once you kind of build that platform, then I wanted to kind of do some kind of a stress testing on that, like JMeter and all that. And then we'll see that, I wanted to see that how that scales up. So basically if I say that I'm doing 10,000 transactions per second, then how would Kubernetes would behave, Mesos would behave, and Swarm would behave. But I could not finish this thing because the time frame what I had. So I kind of did the very small thing. I mean, another app is called DocChat, which we're going to see. So, but we still have something for Magento, what to talk about. So Magento, we can also have one Swarm example, one Kubernetes example I have, but not the extent which I wanted to go for the workshop. But as you are saying that, as if you watch this link, or if you want to contribute here, we're going to update these things over time. Okay. Anyway. So coming back to the DocChat example, so we'll see a simple DocChat example, which is already been done for the DockerCon EU workshop in, I don't know, Barcelona last year, something like that. So they have just talked about Docker Compose, or basically talked about on the Swarm. I did it for, extended to for Kubernetes and for Mesos. So we just see that. So basically, if you take same application and work on three different platforms, we'll know that what would happen if I move my application from one to another one. So this kind of have a common ground. That's our kind of how this approach, that we'll take simple application and deploy it on three different platforms and see what it takes to do that. Okay, let's just take a quick overview of Swarm and then see the examples and Kubernetes and Mesos. So we'll go step by step. Okay. So this link should be here. Yeah. Now try to relate to the things what I mentioned earlier, what you need for the orchestration tool to work together. So now just try to relate what I mentioned earlier and think about that in terms of Swarm, Kubernetes, and Mesos, and how they kind of come and play together. So let's take a 30 seconds view to this kind of diagram and then we move forward. So what you see here is, anybody use Docker machine? Docker machine is something, Docker machine is a tool from which basically you can So now think about a use case. Let's say you are running the Docker on a laptop, is fine. But you are running the Docker nodes on the cloud. Now the one option is you go and log into each of the node every time and do your Docker operation there, like Docker run, Docker pull, or whatever. Other way is that you take your, basically you be in a laptop. You just give the right environment variables for cloud 1, cloud 2, cloud 3, and all that, and you connect to them and just do the work. So this is what is we are saying there, that you are, okay, this is not coming properly, but this is a local laptop what you're sitting here, and there are different machines on your cloud or wherever. So you can just connect to any one of them, do the operation, done. With Docker now go to the other and move on. So this way you can easily manage your containers by sitting locally on another laptop. So yeah. It's okay. So we'll see that example. Yeah. So what do you have here is basically, first of all, these are nodes. What do you have? Like a typical cloud nodes, what do you have? All of them run containers, as they're supposed to be. And then these guys are managed by a cluster called Docker Swarm. And then you have a CLI. And from the CLI, you connect to Docker Swarm. And that Swarm becomes kind of master. Job of the master, as we know, is to first of all schedule the containers where it should go. Schedule the containers, schedule the networking and all that. So basically that Swarm would kind of go and manage those things. So basically you can say now there can be multiple master. Those guys could kind of also have a failover. So if one master goes down, other guys will take over. And you mentioned about some of the key value pairs. So the Docker has something called as libkv. So now again, so you can have multiple key value pair mechanism to identify the single source of truth in your environment. So Docker provides the library for that. So now those can be either etcd, console, or zookeeper. So you can choose one of them with libkv thing. And then you have, I think this is good enough for now, but this is the example that will become much more clear. So Docker Swarm manages a unique token ID for the cluster. So you can say that, okay, now in my cluster, I'm going to have one master, two slaves, or two slaves, one master, or two master, three slaves. So how do you do that? How do you identify that I am part of the cluster? And so basically in the network, you might have multiple environments, right? So you need to identify that I am part of this cluster. So what Docker has, Docker Swarm has kind of unique ID called token ID. So if I generate token ID, and now when you create your Swarm node or master, you get token ID to each one of them. Now because of the same token ID, they know that they're part of the same cluster. And that's how they kind of work together. Libkey, you already mentioned that you can choose any one of them and use it. So Docker kind of trying to try to do different, what do you say, pluggable mechanism for all of them, for storage, for networking, for key value pair and all that. So it did not come properly. So anyway, so basically that again, as I mentioned about networking part, that again done by VXLAN in Docker Swarm. So what do you see here is a container. In the container you have a network sandbox, and this is the endpoint. So think about just endpoint is where the IP address. Sandbox is your kind of, you think about a network namespace. Docker container you already know. So now you can connect different endpoints to each, to multiple containers. So one container can have multiple endpoints. So one container can part of multiple networks. And there are different drivers for lib network. So basically when you're creating the networking driver for your containers, you can choose null, bridge, overlay, and remote. So they are so they should come in like this kind of properly formatted. So null will give you kind of a no IP address when you create the container. Bridge is typically what we already see in the network, that if you start the container, you get a Docker 0 on the machine and you get a container IP address and they talk to each other. Overlay is when you kind of go across the nodes, you connect multiple nodes together, that's when overlay comes in. And remote is being used to kind of create a custom network plugins like companies like Cisco, Juniper. When they're creating their solutions, they create on top of these lib network. So again, just go and search later on. Yeah, so Veeam and Kaleo are kind of on top of the remote plugin what they have. Now, once you create the containers on the Swarm, you can choose how they should be created on the nodes. So basically, if you look at this example, so you would see that some nodes are in three nodes, 30 containers, some nodes are in one container and all that. So this is the strategy what you can decide when you start the container. The strategies can be spread all the time. Build pack means you want to first finish off one node completely and then move to someone else. So this way, if you kind of have less number of nodes, you can just use them properly. Random is like, you guys can just go in random.
Sorry, one question. One agent needs one Docker server?
Yes.
Okay, so I can...
Yep, one agent is one Docker server.
Okay.
One machine in the cloud.
Running on a separate machine?
Yes.
IP and all the network.
Yes.
Okay.
So it's like a typical node. Think about a VM.
Okay.
VM, a physical machine, that can be an agent. And Swarm manages that agent. Actually, they make us tie together and they kind of work. Okay, it's not, you know what, how you do, but yeah. So you can have filters, and so there are filters based on nodes. So basically you can have filter on top of node, and you can have filter per container base. So when you talk about per container node filter, you can say that depending on the health schedule the container is there. For container, you can say depending on affinity, you can say that okay, I want to run my container where my DB container is already running, or I want to run my web container where DB is not running. This kind of affinity, what you can choose, you can choose dependency where only if I start my DB container, then start my web container. So those kind of things you can choose as a part of a scheduling mechanism with Swarm, and you can decide the port also.
Another question, when you say start a container, it's actually start a container, not a server container.
No, it's a container.
It's each container.
It's think about web application, web, Nginx and all that. So we're talking about container, start an Nginx class in web.
Okay.
Now, you need to, as I mentioned earlier, that you need some way to kind of, once you have that, then you have some kind of way to communicate, basically a load balancer, outside world to the inside world communication. So you need to have some kind of way to figure out how they should be connecting. So this is actually everyone knows about HAProxy, right? Load balancing. Anybody is not clear about that? HAProxy, load balancing. Has anybody done? I think everybody has done. Right? I'm guessing that. Okay, so what does the interlock? So interlock is a plugin which they have created for Docker Swarm specifically. So whenever a new application comes or a new new container comes in the environment, it would say, hey, I have come, please book my entry in your database. It's like that, hey, I'm a web container, I have moved the server on from this particular part. So that kind of work is being done with the interlock. And then you can have different external storage plugins, the server, like say Fokker. These are plugins through which you can manage storage for the containers. So you can say, so what would happen is, your shared storage will be mounted on each one of the agent. So when the container moves from one container to one node to another node, your container, your first storage is same, they'll all work whenever they move. Okay, now let's look at some of the workshop part. Currently I'm on my machine, my system, and I do Docker machine.ls. Just going to reduce the font size a bit so that it becomes much more clear. Yep. Are you able to see at the back now? Visible?
No, sorry, I'm a little bit confused. What is the relationship between the machine and the Swarm?
Okay, so Docker machine is a way to manage your VM. Think about this simple. It's a way to manage. So now once you have a single machine, this Docker machine. When you bring the cluster, the top of Swarm.
Okay.
So now, what you are seeing here is I have four or five different machines. One dev, one is Swarm master, other is Swarm master overlay, other is Swarm node one and Swarm node overlay. So there are two different examples we're going to show today. So one is with Docker Swarm on a typical environment. Then we say in the overlay environment. So first we look at the so we have our dev, and then we have, so think about two combination here, a Swarm master and Swarm node one. This is one combination, one of the environment. Swarm master overlay is one. Second combination is Swarm node one overlay is different server, different mechanism. Okay. How many of you have linked to containers earlier? Linked to containers. Have you used a Docker compose file? I'll just give a quick overview of how does the Docker compose file look like and how you kind of work them together. So this is the Docker compose file look like. The Docker compose is a file through which we can link our entire application together. So what you see here is there are two containers that we want to create. So basically we want to build Dockchat application, right? So that's what we're going to build, a Dockchat application. So anybody can kind of do a simple chatting on that. So for that, we create two containers. One is DB container, other is web container. Now, DB container would say that I'm going to expose my DB service on port 27017. So basically, you start the Redis container. Redis, right? Mongo. You take a Mongo image and you create a container from that. And you say that export my other services on port 27017. And there is another container what we have called web container, which is being built from this particular image. And I'm going to say link this container, web container, with the DB container. So I'm going to create a web container. I'm going to say that link my DB container with DB as a kind of a, what you can say, a link name inside the container. Now, why we do that? Because in our web application, what we have written, so basically in the web front end, you want to write a database. So you would have some kind of a program which you would write, right? So for web application, what you're going to write, my Mongo client is DB27017. So basically connect to my database on this port. So this is the code what I have written in my application. Now, how would I say that? How would I going to resolve this DB name, right? In my application, I'm just going to write DB. So now that's why I've given this link, that my DB container is linked to the DB name. Now when I'm going to run my web application like Python program or something, I'm going to say that I connect to my DB on this port. This kind of hard-coded thing. So this is how you're going to write your application. You are, rather than saying the IP address of the container, or the created, you're going to use a link name called DB. So that whenever they get linked together, because it's linked, it will get automatically a DB endpoint. And I'm going to run Mongo, so that's 27017 port. Okay, make sense? Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to connect to my one single. So this dev is not part of any cluster, right? So I'm going to connect to my this particular container or the Docker machine or Docker node. Docker machine. So how do I do that? I'm going to say that okay. Let me show you one thing first. Docker machine, env dev. So what do you see here? These are some variables. What is being there in my shell now? So what this mean when I'm, so Docker run as a Docker client and the master. So client can connect to any of the node. So now if I change, so now see this thing, right? So I'm going to say that my Docker client should connect to this particular host. So think about if I change this to Swarm master. And so basically you see that this is a different IP address, right? This is 100, this is 110. So now, depending on the what I choose, Docker host, my Docker client is going to point to the particular endpoint. Make sense? Okay, so now I'm going to connect to my web dev interface. How I do that, I'll just do this. Now if I do Docker images, I would see Docker images running on the dev machine, dev VM. Okay. Now I'm going to go to my Swarm folder, which is on my GitHub. I'll go to just compose example. And now what I do is Docker compose up. So it says that, okay, it has created the containers and it is being linked on my dev machine IP address on 5000 port. So if I want to get the IP address of my my dev container, I just do this. I get the IP address. I go to browser, connect, 5000. Do something. So this is a simple chat application what has been built because of what we did right now. Make sense? Any questions?
Is there any mechanism to lock starting the Docker images?
Is there any?
Locking mechanism. Because you cannot connect to the database before database is running.
Yeah. That's true. So this will fail actually. This would, if I'm not able to connect, this will fail. Connection timeout. So until you have to, that can you build an application. So when you're writing a web interface, so when you write this chat application, right? So you need to kind of build a kind of a loop here saying that. So either you say loop here saying that while true until I get this thing, or what you can have is something called as dependency here. Say that dependent on this until this doesn't come, don't do that.
Okay.
So that you can have to do that. Yes, the Docker machine is a tool. So it's like, so if you want to run Docker right now, what you do? Yum install a Docker, right? So in that way, what you get is a Docker client and the server both running on some laptop. Is that true, right?
Yes, I run Docker all the time. I see you run Docker machine. I don't know.
Yeah. That's a simple example. So let's think about you. That's what I mean. If you want to manage multiple Docker hosts, multiple Docker servers running on VM on AWS, one VM running on Google Cloud, one running on a local laptop, and all that. But you want to manage from the one laptop, your laptop. So how do you do that? So one way is like you create two separate ones, and then you log in. So basically, you install Docker on each one of the machine. Create the environment variables like the way I showed you, right? Email and everything. That's one way of doing it. Other ways, you can have Docker machine to manage all that. Docker machine can go and install a VM on your cloud environment. You can say Docker machine. Okay, I can show you that. So that's make much more sense actually. So I can say Docker machine -d. -d is Docker machine create -d VirtualBox. My name is, let's say, DevConf. So what this is going to do right now, this is going to create a VM on my VirtualBox here, and it would have all the settings how Docker should be configured so that I can access from my local laptop to this machine, all of those things. So what you can do here is, this driver can be your AWS, can be your Google Cloud, so you can now directly configure that Docker machine, create me a host on AWS, create me a host on wherever. So now you're going to say eventually a new VM going to come up with the DevConf name, and I can do any operation on that. So I'm just going to cut short here, and so that we finish our things, at least what we have to do. So you can play around with the Docker machine later on. So that's one example what I showed you. Now let's move to Docker Compose. So what I'm going to do right now is, this is going to, because I already have a setup ready, so you can follow this instruction and it will create the environment for this particular lab. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to first, so as I mentioned earlier, that Docker Swarm need to have a common token so that they know that they're part of a cluster. So what I will do, I have to generate a new token. So that Docker provides a way to create a token run at runtime. So I'm just going to say that, okay, Docker run Swarm. Swarm is the name of the VM image, and do a create. This then automatically gives me a token ID. Like this token ID. So I can say this token ID, and when I next time I'm going to create, I'm just going to use this token ID and run and create a new master and a slave, and they will be part of the same cluster. So what I take here is, I'll take a token, so I'll create a new one. I say this goes to a token variable. So my token goes in token variable there. Now next time what I do is, I'm going to say that, okay, Docker machine, create, what I'm saying here is, Docker machine, create me a new virtual machine with 2 GB of RAM and make a Docker Swarm master for me. Okay, make a Swarm master for me, and my token is this token, and name it as Swarm master. This is, I'm going to create a master for my Swarm. Next time, I'm going to create a node. So same thing, I'm just going to use the same token ID which I created earlier. So I'm going to say, okay, create me the same token, create me a new Swarm node with the same token ID, so that those become part of the same cluster. Yeah.
So could I use that to set up bare metal machines as well?
Yeah. You can do that. Similarly, I go Swarm node 1 and Swarm node 2, I set up that thing. So in this, I am showing you two nodes, one Swarm master, two Swarm nodes, but in the current VM, I have one master, one node only, because of the RAM limitation. So now you can see that they are part of the same cluster, or same token is being there. Now what I'm going to connect, so I'm going to say that, okay, current my Docker CLI should go and connect Docker Swarm. So I'll say that Docker machine, connect to my Swarm master with environment, give me environment variable for Swarm master. So I have to use this keyword. So there are two ways, I can show you that. So basically, if I go and So see, if I go and look at, just say doc swarm master, sorry, the evil part. The endpoint what I'm getting right now is IP address of the SOM node and the endpoint 2376. So 2376 is a port on which my Docker daemon is running. But if I want a daemon, so basically, okay, let's, if I do a Docker info here, what I'm doing here is I'm just going to connect to my Docker daemon right now. Sorry. So see what I'm getting right now output as. I'm going to connect to my swarm node and I have two containers, this many image, and this is a typical Docker info what I get. But what I want an output of a cluster wide. So what I have to go and say here, rather than just the swarm, ENVS swarm master, I have to specify a new keyword called swarm. And if I now do the Docker info, I get a cluster wide output. I have a swarm node, I have a swarm master. See, this is swarm master, this is swarm node, this runs on, this is two container, this is two one container. So this way I can get a cluster wide view. Yeah. But I have to connect to the right endpoints. I cannot just connect to the Docker endpoint. I have to connect to the swarm endpoint and then I get it. Okay. Now I'm going to create a, I'm going to use the same Docker file, same compose file, and I'm going to again start the Docker compose up ls, sorry, ps. So again I'm going to get IP address because I'm running on one sorry, so this gives me that where I'm running. Now if I go to this IP address, I would get my same application, whatever, right? So thing is, so just remember that you're getting searched from one container itself right now. Okay, I'll just see that. Makes sense? Any questions? I don't see any questions. Yeah. As a speaker, you are happy when you see more questions. So yeah. I would appreciate if you have more questions so that I know that what I'm talking about really makes sense. Okay. So now the next.
So you created the swarm master and
nope.
just the same, we also create swarm node 1 and 2. Just like the last parameter.
No, just you have to change the, you have to kind of just do one more change there. So it's always everything is there. So it's just that I don't specify a Docker swarm master keyword here. I just specify, I just skip that part. Just call
yeah.
Paste stick and that should be okay because this is a part of node.
And can you show what containers are running on your nodes right now?
Yeah, that you can do.
You have started the same application on both nodes, right?
No, I'm not doing it right now. I just created a cluster right now. So basically, if I. So if I do Docker PS, I would now. So basically, let me just do the shutdown first. So I'll show you what happened, what I have done. So I'm going to the Docker compose rm kill. This might be part of, why is it not coming? Okay, I'm on a different folder actually. So let me go to the right folder. So I was here, and here I was. So as you see, I don't have any container right now. Now what I do is, with Docker compose file, I'm the same thing, nothing what you have changed. So I'm just going to say Docker compose. So Docker compose is something which in through which you can create a cluster, a link together, link container and create a complete application. So I just say docker compose up minus d, and now I have a docker ps. I will get, there are two containers, one for web, one for db. They're connected together and I can access them over the web.
Yeah, but if you have two nodes and you would like these containers to run across those two nodes,
yeah,
I would like to see the, that they are running out on the two
nodes. Yeah, we're coming there.
Okay.
This is just a single node right now. This is just that it's going to run the same node.
Simple question. Before you, let's say you are not using Docker Compose, yes? You create the pull from Swarm, from the image, and how do you run the, how do you create the cluster with Docker commands? Swarm.
Yeah, so there are two ways. You can just create multiple.
Run the compose.
Yeah, so router you can do, so think about this is a simple example. So basically you can create first Docker, you can just say Docker, okay, so the example, okay, let me just do that. Let's take time. So what I can do is create first container, I can just say Docker run, minus minus name, db1, and I can say Mongo, and I just need to run the background. So now you can see I have three containers running, right?
Mm-hmm.
With the name db1, with the db1, this one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now I can just create a new container, I can just link, create a new container, and I can say web1, and I can say minus minus link, db1, because I have used db inside, I have to link with the db only. And then I have to change my image name to Ankare slash Docker chat v1.
You're missing one dash.
Where?
Link button.
Oh, yeah.
But still, it's a warning.
Sorry?
Mm-hmm. It was a warning. But
because now there is NK.
Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
No, I missed this thing. Okay, so doc chat. Yeah. So now you see that I got, did the linking, right? So now I can just get the IP address, docker inspect. Oh, I did not do the port mapping, so I need to, so, what I have to do is basically, I create a new container with a new name, and I say that minus p, I say 9000 port of the host goes to this guy, and then inside, and I need to change the name here. I just say web2. What happened?
I return you. Delete with backspace, it screws the command line.
Oh man. Docker run minus d, minus name, db3, link db1 as db, and then say minus p 8, let's say 900 to 5000 the container. And Ankare talk chat one should be okay, right? Yeah, so now I know the I should get the IP address of my current node, so I get my eco docker host. So now I can go to this particular endpoint and click on 8900, and I should be able to do that. Okay, this is how the compose works, and you can do it either link, but this is what we are doing on the same node, right? But eventually you want to scale, right? That's the where you want to go in production. We have multiple nodes, and we should be able to run the application to multiple nodes, right? So now I mentioned about interlock. So let's just look at that. This we are done here. So
So what we are going to do here, so look at the compose file is being changed right now. So in the compose file, what is being changed is we have added a new container called Interlock in place of just a web and DB container. And now what Interlock job is to basically whenever a new container comes in, it would kind of make sure that I am, so now let's say in one container, it would have like I can have 5 links to the other container. So it's like, okay, let me show you that. That would make sense. So one more thing I just want to kind of mention here is, so this is fine, right? We understand DB container, we understand web container. And what we didn't do right now is, if you recall the earlier earlier Docker file, we mentioned here 5000:5000. This was like 5000:5000. We now removed this 5000. Now you want to kind of don't want to export a port from the machine on which this container is running. Now what we also have is in the web container we are mentioning also the some environment variable saying that my DB container would be or my web container would be export as a dockerchat.com because that's when we need to mention in the nginx file that if anything from an Nginx on Docker chat, serve this particular page. So this is nothing but an Nginx Nginx application with some more configuration there. And I'm going to have an interlock container, which is being created from here. And I'm saying that map port 80 of the host machine on which is running to the port 80 of the container. And I'm giving some details about so that it can manage the global definition from volume information. And this I have to give because this is a kind of a trick what I have done. So if you are able to see this thing is that I have mentioned a constraint here, right? And the constraint what I'm saying that run this interlock only on the SOM master, don't run anywhere else. Now because interlock needs the SOM signing authority like signs like keys, permission keys and all that, TLS keys. So I'm saying that mount that particular volume, so where live boot Docker contains the keys for the interlock or Docker SOM. I just mounted this thing inside the container because of the volume plugin, and I say that when you are connected to Docker SOM, use this particular keys from this particular folder. Anyway, if you kind of go in detail, you will understand that. So what I do right now is I'll just go there in that particular folder. I just first clean up this. Docker compose. So I'm going to go into this interlock folder, and now again I have to Docker compose minus D up. And now I see Docker compose ps. So now what I'm going to do is rather than accessing the web container, I'm going to access the interlock container. So this IP address of the interlock container is going to be my SOM master because that's where I kind of bind it to. And I'm going to go to my this particular folder, and I'm going to do this. Sorry, which one? 192.168. What happened? Oh, it's 110. No, what I'm missing.
The port is
Seems fine.
Don't you need to access it via some host name because it looks like...
Correct, sorry. Yeah, that's what the problem with... So I need to just change and my... Sorry, yeah, that's the right good point. Thank you, Lars. Because that's what it accepts the... doc chat, it should be 110. Because the Nginx would not allow it to do it, so yeah. Now I can go to docchat and access it, right? So now this is what I'm doing is just like this is typical of what you already had, but now look at the magic. What we can do is we can now scale it dynamically. So what we're going to say is now rather than just one thing, scale it up to, let's say I want to say scale it to 5. So I'm just going to say docker scale web to 5. So I'm going to go and say, so now my application is now scaling. And now if I go and go to doc chat, now look at this ID. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
But, okay, so this is now what we do is docker compose ps. But you are seeing here is all the containers have been starting on the one node only, 110. But what you want is across the nodes. Now, this will not work, so basically this is okay for running on one particular node. Why is not going across the nodes? Because what we wanted is we need to understand. So, see if it is if the web want to get the if web want to connect to DB, it will just say web connect to DB is in this port. Now it has to know that a DB is running on this node only. This is the current constraint what we have because we cannot access the container across the nodes right now because we don't have an overlay network. The current network is on the overlay network. So what we have to do is. The current setup looks like that is you have only one machine, and one machine you're creating first a DB container and one web container, right? And if you recall in the web what you mentioned, connect to DB on some port number, right? Now, in this current scenario, web cannot go to other machine. So web cannot say, web cannot connect to DB on the other machine because we haven't configured the overlay network. Only when you configure overlay network, then only we can cross the nodes. So with current environment or Docker Compose and thing, you can just go across the container of the same machine. But you want to cross the nodes, then you have to have some kind of a network which they understand together. So we have to kind of first create the Docker overlay network, only then we can do that. So now we're just going to, again now we're just going to come say scale one. So automatically, four of them would be down. And if we do, now we have get back to the original state. Okay. Now we go to the other folder in the same here. So one master, two nodes, overlay. So now we don't have a link parameter. If you recall now we don't have any link parameter in the web thing, right? Earlier we used to have link db to colon db, something like that, right? Now what we have a net is called docker chat, doc chat. So what are we going to create? We are going to create a network of overlay, and this network would be named as docker chat, doc chat. So once we create this global network, then we should be able to go across the nodes. So this is a again compose file modified with the name as net is equal to docchat on each one of them. Okay. Now again the same thing, docker compose, not down. First I think we need to create the network. So let me just go to the instructions. If we don't miss something. So now in this we are going to change the, so if you recall that we have two interfaces, I have two setup here, docker machine ls. So now I'm going to connect to Docker. So now I'm going to connect to SOM master, which is on the top of overlay. So I mentioned that I have two SOM master setup, one SOM master, one SOM node one, and I have other one SOM master overlay. So I'm going to connect to Docker. So I want to say that again the eval thing, and I want to say that connect to the system which has overlay network. So I'm going to just change here to overlay. So now I would have no container there. I can say Docker network ls. So what you have is, I already have, so basically with Docker network ls, lib network, what you have, you can have, I mentioned about different kind of networks there, bridge, host, null. So now I'm saying I have a network named docchat here. How do you create that? You just do this thing, Docker network create overlay network and with the subnet. That's it. Now I'm going to do the same up minus d. So Docker machine, Docker compose. Yes. Now you see that this container, this web is running on 113. Now I'm going to say scale. And I'm going to say 5. Now see. So 13, 12, 12. So this down web end can be managed by different machines also. So they can go across nodes.
So if you remove the link, how does it know in configuration the register should?
Now it's not linked, because so now what would happen? Okay. So if now what happens is, when you create these containers, so now you, that's what I said. Now comes the service discovery part.
Mm-hmm.
Now you should always dynamically say that I should well do that. So first of all, this interlock what we're creating here, right? This interlock. So this says that how I'm going to connect to these guys. First of all, that part. And second part is, there would be an entry in each machine. So let's just, I'm just guessing that, because it is used to happen. So basically now I'm going to say Docker. So I'm going to inside one other container. Underscore web 2 bash env. Yeah. So now what I'm going to see here, like this application, like most interlock data is this thing. So what going to happen is, rather than giving the, so what used to happen earlier is, when you do a linking, the host name of the previous container goes inside the other container with linking part. Now here, because I'm interlock, this is saying that docchat domain docchat, and this is how it, this is how it's going to export it to the interlock. Interlock was going to manage that. So interlock was going to have it in the database inside that. How I'm going to connect the links together dynamically. So yeah, it's not going to be very easy. I need to kind of put some time around there and understand that. But what does interlock has? It has a kind of mechanism to identify where the web containers are running, and you can then access that. Okay, so I'm just going to close this thing right now for Docker Swarm. We'll now go to the Kubernetes part, because we just have 20 minutes left. But I think the concepts are clear, then we should be able.
I don't understand, how does the Python application now know where the database is?
Oh, so that's what I mentioned earlier, right? Okay.
So I understand the link, I understand, then it modifies the etc host, now it knows, but when you introduce the network, how does it know where the...
Correct. So when you write the Python application, right, you access like this.
Yes.
Correct?
Mm-hmm.
So now when I'm going to, so basically if you look at this part, right, so I'm going to create different web, but they won't touch the same DB. So see this thing, right, one master, two node overlay, DB1, right? So in each of these Python application, right, they are all running the same web application, same code, and same code I have written, try to DB in this thing. Now interlock is going to manage that thing for you. So interlock is going to say where, so as a web application, I would go to interlock, where I am running the DB. You go and give me the IP address of that. This is how HA proxy and all things come together. When you look at the example of Kubernetes, it will be much more clear. Just think about this, like now we move from Kubernetes, Docker Swarm to the Kubernetes world. Okay. So we look at Swarm right now. Swarm is again managed, it's like a container orchestration tool, right? Now come to Kubernetes. Kubernetes is also the same kind of tool. So what you get at Docker Compose is, you get the same Docker binaries, right? Docker, not binaries. Same command line to use, Docker machine, Docker Swarm, Docker. So basically don't, your workflow does not change much. But what you have to do in that cost is, you have to create a new interlock mechanism, link them together and all that. So Docker Swarm does not have inbuilt HAProxy thing.
So you have to kind of have something external to do that. That's first drawback of Storm. Otherwise, you don't have a mechanism to currently do the DNS part. So basically, when you, that interlock has been doing it for you. Basically, you can connect dynamic definition that where should my web is running, where my DB is running. But Kubernetes have all of those things built together. Kubernetes architecture overall looks more or less same. Not much, they're too different, but ideas, you again have one master, you have multiple nodes. So this is your master, this is your two different nodes, and there can be multiple nodes. Master communicates to the slaves, saying that, give me, run my container on this node right now, or whatever it is. So basically, so it gives the work to the slaves. It can tell how many copy of application I want to run. It would say, so in terms of, now one more difference in terms of Swarm and Kubernetes is, in that we are dealing with one container at a time in Kubernetes, in Swarm. We said that web container, DB container. So now that is, eventually you want to deploy an application. In terms of Kubernetes, that calls it a pod. So when I'm going to deploy a pod. Think about the link what we did in the Docker link command, right? We did the Docker link command. In Kubernetes, in the pod, we would do that particular linking inside the pod. So in the pod, you can have one or more containers, and they are linked together on localhost. So you would have, so think about your unit is not container right now, your unit is a pod.
Yep, can you run multiple containers on multiple Docker hosts, but in one pod? It's like if I want to have cluster application and one node to be on remote Docker host.
They are going to all remote only. They are going to be all different machines only. So you will have, you can have node, so in Kubernetes you have one master, one or more master, then you have multiple nodes, or the minions you can tell, or slaves.
Yeah.
So you will have one or more slaves, and the slave can be part, master can also be a slave, but generally you don't do that. So you will have multiple slaves there. Master would go into say, okay, deploy my application. Now in terms of Kubernetes, the application is a pod. Rather than a unit is a container on Swarm, here unit is a pod. In the pod, you would have the web and DB, what we saw earlier, right? The doc chat thing. That is one pod. Now you deploy those pods across machines. So that pod goes across machines. Rather than one container, the pod goes across machines. Make sense?
So minion doesn't map to
slave. Yes, slave.
They're just a slave.
The slave node.
But it's an abstract kind of concept. It's not a machine. Kind of like it's not a host or something.
No, it's a host.
It's a host.
It's a host. So basically, you take first VM. On the VM, you would configure. Okay, this is my. This would work as a minion. So
okay.
You're going to start a service as minion or the node on the node.
Yes,
so
that's understood.
Oh yeah. So I don't understand it again because
yeah.
I meant. I have we have one cluster machine, and I want the nodes of the cluster machine on very different physical locations. So
yeah, that'd be good.
So then I thought a minion is like Dockerhost, one physical machine, let's say, or virtual machine, whatever. And then on this kind of visualization, it looks like that you can have in that pod, you can have like collection of containers.
Yes.
But it looks like the pod with the whole containers must be under one node.
Yes, yes. You cannot, yes, yes.
So
the pod
actually interconnected.
Yeah, pod is a unit. Pod is a unit. And that unit is a, basically you cannot divide the unit.
So
you deploy.
I would have to create two pods and connect together?
No. So your application is one web and one DB, which you saw. That goes in one pod.
Yeah. Okay.
So now that pod can be replicated multiple times. So an application will get replicated, rather than per container, your application will get replicated,
mm-hmm.
Whatever times you would say.
But across the,
so
across
actually,
I want to leverage, right? I've got multiple machines, right? So I've got blueprint container. That's what we call it web app right there, right?
Just a minute.
And
okay. Yeah.
We've got a pod full of web apps, right? So we want to.
I'll just show you a quick demo.
Okay. Yeah.
That would make much more because we don't have enough time. Yeah, don't worry. Just kind of once you go back, just try out this thing. You should be able to identify all of this thing. Okay, so this is the definition. So, so what Kubernetes has? Kubernetes has a kind of the one what we saw in the Docker Compose file. Docker Compose file. Here you would find different service file and different replication controller of a pod file. So what I'm going to say here is I'm going to define my application as two things. One is currently I'm just going to say that my container is going to get created from this particular image, the what we saw. I'm going to say like the way we use interlock there, I'm going to say that my name of this container as the front end name. So I'm going to give it as front end. And I'm saying that this particular thing is going to be referred as front end. So I'm going to create a container from this particular image, and that would be called as a front end. Okay, that's all you have to remember right now. And when I'm going to get the name, I want front end name, I'm going to look at the DNS. So look at my service discovery, right? How I'm going to say that, give me front end. What is the IP of my front end? So that I'm going to get from the DNS. And this is the code we're exporting earlier anyway, 5000. So this is the part of how do you create a pod. Okay, now in this pod, I don't have DB right now. My DB is in a separate part, as a separate pod. So I can have DB and front end as a part of one pod, but I can have a separate them also.
Okay.
That's up to you. In this, I'm not doing that. Yep.
With any amount of rep.
Correct.
With any amount of rep.
Correct. Yeah. And now I'm going to say service file. So now you remember service discovery part. So I'm going to create. So that's my pod name. So I'm going to say that refer my that pod as a front end service. Okay.
Let's just look at the demo.
So I'm going to manage my cluster with the kubectl command, kubectl get nodes. So I am running three nodes on the Google Cloud right now for this particular example, because again the same how many VMs I can run. So they are all ready. Now I say get pods, give me pods. No pods right now. Give me service. No service right now. Oh, there's one command, it's by default service. Now I want to say first create service, so now DB service, and I'm going to say DB controller. So see, the controller is being used to run how many pods I want to run. So let's say if I are running three pods or four pods, I want to refer all of them by DB service name. So I'm going to have one common service name to refer multiple pods. I'm going to create similarly for front end. So DB is again like the one which is a Mongo thing. We again say go front end service and go front end controller. Sorry, kubectl get pods. So now you see that I'm running two different pods. And I am running some services here. So now, what I'm also seeing is that in my service for my front end, I mentioned as front end, or I mentioned as type as load balancer. I'm running this thing on the Google Cloud. I'm going to use the load balancer given by the Google. And now I can scale n number of frontends. The way I did for Docker Swarm, I can also go and say scale my frontend to n, whatever I want to specify there. So, but before that, I wanted to show something. So now I get this IP address of my service for my just one application, which has one pod of DB, one pod of frontend. I can say 5,000. Now I should be able to access the same application which I did there. It's fine. Now this container is just one. Now I'm going to scale it to, let's say I want to scale it to 5. Again, same thing.
Over 9,000.
Sorry?
No, it's okay. Two is good.
Two is good. So how would I have the scale command? Yeah. So I just say 3. Okay. Yeah. So now if I do kubectl get pods, I would see that my front end 3 pods are being started. Now again, if I go here, now you would see that those number would change. This should change, right? This way I can scale up to any one of the nodes, any number of containers. So now I can now scale up, scale down, depending on my need.
And this tier description, was that kind of like the instance of a service?
Which one?
And then the YAML file you showed before, there was a tier key.
Tier is nothing, I think it's just a kind of, just a label. Just a lib. So I can define my, so I would recommend that you guys go and look at this particular presentation. So I think we just have 5 more minutes left,
mm-hmm.
or maybe
five
less
minutes.
Than that.
Yeah.
So basically, I would recommend you guys go and look at this particular presentation. This would give you the overall concepts. It should be good.
Quick one. When you scale, it's always in the same Docker node, right?
No, there are different nodes now. So you can, okay, I'll show you that. So basically, you can say that kubectl get pods minus override.
You have two unions, if you will.
Yeah, so see, they are different names. See, these are running on different machines.
Yeah. I know there are different containers, but I say in the physical machine that you're, virtual machine actually, that you're running, every Docker container, when you scale, it's always in the same pod, in the same,
they will be on different machines.
Okay, they're distributed.
Yeah. That's why it's needed, right? You don't have fault tolerance in the trusted environment, right? There's no point running all the containers on one machine, all the pods on one machine.
Yeah, that was just like in your diagram.
Yeah, so I showed multiple examples, actually. I showed multiple examples. So if you kind of go back, look at the entire thing, you should be able to clear the picture. And you can definitely drop me an email if you have any questions. Now, just quickly look at the Mesos one. We'll not show the demo here, but I'll just quickly... So how many of you used Mesos earlier? Anybody use Mesos? Okay, so Mesos, the same analogy, you need to look at master slave. So you have one master, more master, you would have more slaves. Then you would have zookeeper as a key value pair. And Hadoop, so basically Mesos is just not about containers. It is a general framework to run any distributed jobs. So for containers, it has a marathon scheduler. So basically, Docker must talk to the scheduler. So basically, you have framework actually. So basically, you would have a framework for containers, this marathon. So what does Mesos does? Mesos master basically collects all the resources of all the machines, put them in a kind of pool, and then how many CPU I have, how many RAM I have, and all that. And it will give it to the. So what's happening here is these are slaves. Slaves first go and say, okay, I have. One server, I have 4 CPU, I have 4 GB RAM. That goes to the master. Master then say, okay, go to the framework and say that, the framework is Marathon in this case. Let's take an example of Marathon. I want to run 5 containers with this much of RAM and everything. So scheduler, master would go and give this to the framework. Framework would say, okay, now I have enough resources. It would go and give this.